What's up, guys? Today's junk are five pet peeves that I have from my landscaping lawn care business. Now, these are things that that customers, mostly new customers that haven't developed a relationship with me yet, that try to do, or they're not aware of that this is going to be counterproductive. So some of these things I experience often, some of these things I experience very infrequently. But usually, once I develop a reasonable professional relationship with a regular customer over a short period of time with multiple jobs, these problems tend to go away. So I'm going to go through them in no particular order, and we're going to start with number one now. So the first issue I call is the bid king. This is when you get a call from a customer to come out and bid a job or give an estimate, whatever the terminology that you use in your field. So for landscaping or lawn care, I'll get a text, a call, an email, whatever, even a submission through the website to come out and take a look at a job. And it could be something as minimal as just a lawn cut, and they want to see what it would cost for weekly cuts. Or it could be a massive landscaping job where I have to clear things out, plant new things, whatever it might be. I call this person the bid king when I get there, and sometimes there's other landscapers there trying to bid the same job with an estimate at the same time, or they just casually mention during my conversation with them that they're expecting other bids and estimates. At that point, once this is made aware to me, I usually mentally and emotionally take a step back from this job, because chances are I'm not going to get it. And if I do get it, there's a very good chance that this person is extremely particular and or not willing to spend the money they need to for a good job. So the bid king, most of the time, in my experience, as I get better, I avoid. So let's move on to number two. The next situation that I try to avoid is what I would like to call the caller. This is a person that just calls frequently, and they, for whatever reason, feel like they need to really be on top of me. Now, this applies mostly to the weekly lawn maintenance. So at the beginning of the relationship, whether it's at the beginning of the season or I pick them up halfway through or what have you, I will be as clear as I can with my expectations of how I'm going to perform the job. Weekly, bi-weekly, edge cut, trim, blow, the whole bit. I will be here the first half of the week, mostly Mondays and Tuesdays, depending on weather and workload. That's kind of the conversation I have. Well, it's not uncommon for this person to start calling me on Sunday afternoon, asking me what day I will be there. Or I go there, take care of the job, and a few minutes later, they call me about something that either I missed, or one thing that they just wanted to mention for next time, or something. I'm just cutting grass. It's not rocket science. It does take a level of detail, don't get me wrong, but it's grass, okay? This doesn't happen all the time. I don't want you to think I'm getting calls left and right, but the few people that I've had in the past do this frequently tend to be the ones that go with somebody else the following year. And it just seems to be, at least in my experience, that there's a level of unrealistic expectations for what they're looking for. And this results in multiple calls and contacts throughout the week about their lawn getting cut. So that's that. Let's talk about number three. The third situation is more to deal with the property itself. I've had a couple of calls and estimates requested for a lawn. I get out there and it's a massive property. It could be 2 acres. And I got no problem cutting 2 acres. I just charge accordingly. But they have a 24-inch gate to get into the backyard of this 2-acre property. And it's just impossible. I could use a 21-inch mower to mow the whole thing, but I'm going to charge according to my time. And then when they don't understand what the story is, why am I charging so much when I have this big mower on my trailer? The reason being is I can't use the big mower. So now I have to charge according to the time it takes and the effort involved and everything. And I have, in the past, unsuccessfully suggested this a few times. I came across this idea on a forum somewhere on, I think it was Lawn Sites. Anyway, somebody suggested, as a lawn care provider, that I offer to build a bigger gate out of their fence at no charge, as long as they sign a long-term contract ensuring that I can recoup my cost in time, along with making an additional profit by cutting their grass. After building the gate, I can now get my big mower in, saves time and money for everybody, and they get a bigger gate out of it. I've never had anyone take me up on that, and I've suggested that two or three times. So I call this the impossible lawn. There are other types of impossible lawns. There is a property with my old lawn mowing job where the customer, extremely sweet lady, but she had probably 200 or 300 garden gnomes all throughout the property. The backyard was sectioned off with several little chain link fence areas. She had dogs in a pool, and she didn't want the dogs getting into the pool. And then there was a whole nother section that just wasn't relevant. And the 36 inch mower did fit through these gates, but not with the bag on. So I had to take the bag off, walk it through the fence, come back out, get the mower, go through the fence, put the bag back on, shut the gate behind me, get back to work. And it was very cumbersome. So this falls under impossible lawns. Another impossible lawn type is where you just got an overabundance of landscaping. And this really slows down the process of cutting a lawn. So multiple beds, multiple lawn flamingos, whatever you got, it just tone it down. You want a nice lawn? That's fine. But if you're going to make it difficult to cut, don't expect to have to charge or pay a premium to your lawn care guy if it comes down to that. Let's talk about the next one. The next one I like to call, and I got this phrase from somebody else that I used to work with, called the Hey Kenyas. The Hey Kenyas are, you're working, you're at the job site, you're in the middle of mowing, you're on the sulky, you're flying by, customer comes out and waves you down. So you have to get off the mower, you put all the gearing back into place, and you turn down the idle. They walk over and they say, hey, Kenya. Like, hey, while you're at it, or while you're doing that, can you do that? And it's usually something stupid, but the problem with this is they then had set a precedent. If you agree to these Hey Kenyas frequently, they start to see this as something that they can do frequently, and it's okay with you, it's okay with them. They're getting free work and labor. This is difficult to deal with, especially if it's a long-term customer that hasn't really done that many Hey Kenyas. If that's the case, chances are you're going to suck it up like me and just go take care of it. If it's like 5 minutes or less, what's the big deal? You're just ensuring a good relationship. But if it becomes a habit, that's where it becomes an issue. Or if it takes, you know, more than a couple of minutes to do, it's not a Hey Kenya. That's another job all on itself. So depending on what it is, usually I combat this with the following. If it's a quickie and it's a reasonable thing, I'll just do it. You know, no big deal. I'll just go after it and take care of it, whatever. If it's a bigger deal and it needs more attention, more detail, and more equipment, and it's actually a job, while they're describing it to me, I got my mower running in the background, I'm trying to get back to work, excuse me, I'll say something like, I'd be happy to give you an estimate for that. And that usually sets the tone for the remainder of the conversation, whether they're willing to pay for it or not, and they might not even understand the depth of the job. If it's something bigger than what they realize, then it's something I got to take care of, and I'm going to have to charge for that. That's just the sad, unfortunate fact. But like I said, if it's a quickie for a regular customer and it's not a big deal and it's not something I do often, I'll just take care of it. But if it's a newer customer and I can see this becoming a habit, I'll throw that comment out. I'll be happy to give you an estimate for that. And that usually sets the tone, like I said. My last one, and this is the one that I hate the most. I just want it cleaned up a bit. Or just clean it up. Okay, so these are customers that you go and give an estimate. Usually I get contacted through an email or a phone call for things like this. And, you know, hi, I'm looking for Joe. I have a job that I just want it cleaned up, or I just want the beds cleaned out. And I get there and it's a jungle. It hasn't been touched since the Nixon administration, and it's just It's ridiculous to say, I just want it cleaned up. And then you shoot them a price of a couple hundred or even $1,000 to get everything out of there, get it back down the clean dirt or clean soil, whatever is there, and cart everything away or put it at the curb, whatever the details of the job are, just to clean it up. It's going to cost some money. The reason why I hate this the most is because of a couple of reasons. First, they're always surprised at the price. Second, they also always have plants and shrubs in there that they want to keep, but they're very vague and ambiguous about that. So it's hard for me to know what they're thinking when they say, I just want it cleaned up. And then they sometimes go through the trouble of pointing to each plant. I want this one kept. I want this one gone. I want that one gone. I want this one kept. It's not practical. It can be difficult. It can be done. Don't get me wrong. But it's very... the minutia of it all. It's ambiguous and it's difficult to follow along. So I tend to stay away from the I just want it cleaned up jobs. I'll do a tear down where I'll rip everything out and then I'll replace it with new plants. I'm happy to do that because that's a vision that is tangible. That is something that both I can describe and even draw it up on grid paper, on graph paper, and show the customer what I'm thinking. That is way more doable than a just clean it up type of thing. So those are my current pet peeves after being in the business for a number of years at this point, and I've been on my own for a little while now, and these are the things that I've developed. So that's that. Hope you guys liked this video, and if you did, please click like, comment, share, and subscribe. And as always, I can be found on Twitter and Instagram at Gettin Junk Done. Thanks for watching.